Taking a look at England's most two recent results against Brazil and Belgium. Two friendlies, one defeat and one draw. So it wasn't the best international breaks for them. James Olley was there for all of it. We've got Frank Leboeuf still with us as well. Where does this latest round leave them, James?
Yeah, it was a bit of a chaotic camp, really. I mean, if you go right back to the start with, you know, the raft of withdrawals and injuries, Harry Kane obviously very rarely misses his internationals, even the friendly games. And obviously, as captain, he's a key part of what Gareth Southgate's doing. He wasn't available. There are a number of other withdrawals. Ben White, of course, refused a call-up, which kind of dominated the headlines initially. Then there was the whole furore around the St. George's flag on the back of the new Nike kit. Then there were more withdrawals after the defeat of Brazil. And then Southgate sort of said himself, you know, he kind of had this plan on Saturday night for the game on Tuesday. They got ripped up within 12 hours and he was kind of almost throwing a team together by the end. But I guess nothing sort of sums up the chaos a little bit as much as, you know, a teenager who wasn't even selected in the original squad making a near irrefutable case by the end to go to Euro 2024. And that was Kobbie Mainoo, who, you know, really impressed, I thought, against Belgium. And even in the little cameo he had against Brazil, looked bright, looked sharp. And I think there's a little bit of a desperation to sort of board the hype train with him because he fills a problem position that England have had for a long time, predating Southgate, a long way, that they don't have somebody who can kind of dictate games in midfield. You think about the games that got away from them, even under Southgate, the Euro 2020 final in the second half, and Verratti and Jorginho kind of took it over for Italy. Luka Modric 2 years earlier for Croatia in that 2018 semi-final. You know, and obviously France have those players who can really just take control of matches. I'm not suggesting that Mainoo's there yet, but he's got the potential to be that kind of player who could really give England an authority, a composure, a maturity in the middle of the park. And he was a real bright spot. But I think coming out of it, Southgate's quite confused, really, about his final 23. From what I hear, I think he's one of the coaches that's lobbying UEFA to try and get that 23 pushed up to a 26-man squad. And I think that's a reflection, really, of just the volume of injuries that England have got at the moment. Of course, they don't have another friendly now until he names his provisional squad on May the 16th. As I say, he had so many withdrawals here, and he had one or two players. Anthony Gordon looked bright. Kobbie Mainoo, as we've already talked about. He had Cole Palmer he brought in, who wasn't really able to use because of injuries. And then there's a sort of longer-running debates about Jordan Henderson and Calvin Phillips and whether those players are worthy of a place in the summer squad. And I think he probably wanted to come out of this with a lot more clarity than he ended up with.
It's interesting that what you mentioned there about Mainoo and the profile that he gives, because Gareth Southgate said that afterwards, didn't he? He said he gives them...
That begs a question.
Exactly. Why
was he not in the squad in the first place, even before the great performance?
He says it's a profile of a player that they don't have right now. Is it just that he's noticed this now, having played him in these games?
But hold on. It begs the question why he wasn't in the initial squad to have a look at him. And this was we've said this, James, even before the Liverpool game. Why you want to look at Jordan Henderson and other players in the squad when you can have a look at these youngsters?
I think there's two reasons. One is, if you look at, generally speaking, it's not easy to get into a Gareth Southgate squad, right? You think about players like Jack Grealish, James Maddison, they had to earn, Ivan Toney before the ban, they've had to sort of earn their way. Trent Alexander-Arnold's a really good example. You know, somebody who had to really, even though he was impressing, excelling, I mean, Alexander-Arnold had won, you know, Champions Leagues with Liverpool and he couldn't get in the England team. He was 50-50 to get in the squad a lot of the time. Southgate's not someone to sort of accept those bolters, you know, we tend to call them, you know, someone who comes out of nowhere to suddenly excel into a tournament sort of 3, 4, 5 months out. He has his squad, and I think a lot of that is based on the culture. You know, he's worked so hard to get a culture there, a group of players who want to play for England, and I think that's led to a bit of excessive loyalty. You know, I think we've seen that with Calvin Phillips in particular, Harry Maguire when he was having his difficult time at Manchester United, Jordan Henderson to some extent when he went to Saudi Arabia. And that maybe is where it bleeds into the situation with Mainoo, where from what I was told, and we actually did a story on ESPN it was about 4 or 5 weeks ago, that I was told that there was a big debate internally about whether they were going to fast-track Mainoo into the under-21s or whether they were going to put him into the senior squad. And there was a lot of talk around St George's Park about the staff thinking he was ready to go straight in, And Southgate felt, well, actually, you know, he's only played, I think, 20-odd senior games for Manchester United. And they felt maybe this tournament's come a bit too soon and maybe we need to give, you know, Calvin Phillips, who was, remember, Player of the Year for England a couple of years ago, a bit more time. Jordan Henderson, who's a key part of the leadership group, feels he gives them a lot off the pitch, arguably more than he does on it. And he sort of thinks, well, do we have a place in that 23-man squad for someone like Maine, who's played so few games at a senior level? But it kind of makes a mockery of all of that when you see him go and play against Belgium like he did.
I mean, I suppose, you know, he was loyal to Phillips until recently, and rightly so. Phillips hasn't played well enough in Harry Maguire, but I suppose those were positions that maybe he didn't have an abundance of other players, and I think that position at centre-half on both games showed it's a problematic position. If something was to happen to John Stones and Kyle Walker, you know, where does he go? What does he do? You know, we saw Enzo Konza play. He's a good player. We saw Dunk play, make a mistake. He's a good player, bit slow, and for, you know, and I think that could cause him some problems at international football. That's a big issue for Gareth Southgate. You know, we have two of the favourites for this tournament, France and England, who I think have got big worries at their back four. We saw France play and get beat handsomely by Germany, and deservedly so, with Benjamin Pavard and Upamecano, and they were a disaster. They had William Saliba. We talked about it. Why the hell's he not giving this guy a game? Best, you could argue, he's been the best defender in England, if not in Europe, in the last 18 months. And I know he played in the friendly that's just gone. But even Didier Deschamps, he's got more to pick from, but he's juggling his back four. But I think that, again, is going to be England's Achilles heel when they get to this tournament, that if they get an injury or two to those players that I mentioned, who's he going to bring in? And how are they going to have a back four that's good enough to win this tournament?
Craig, well, I have no sympathy for Deschamps or Gareth Southgate in that matter. In a way that they've been there for a while. They know all their players. They know how they play. It's their job to find the chemistry and to find the players and to have one player and the substitute and the substitute of the substitute. They've been there for a while. They have no excuse whatsoever to struggle to find somebody else. They have what we call a problem of rich people. You know, it's like, oh, well, I have to get the bread. You know, do I get the Maserati or the Porsche? You know, that's what it is with France and England. They have, okay, Harry Kane is a big-time player, but they have other strikers. They have a midfielder, they have a prime. They can find somebody else. I mean, we've been there. At 98, Aimé Jacquet decided to not take, imagine, Cantona and Ginola. That's a problem of rich people. And that's what it is for Gareth Southgate and Didier Deschamps. And for me, they've been there so many years as a leader of their selection, of their team, national teams, that they should be able to cope with all situations. And for me, they have no excuses.
But I think France have, I wouldn't call it an embarrassment of riches, but he's leaving arguably the best defender in England and William Saliba out. Southgate is not. I mean, how much of a problem is this, James, for Southgate? I mean, it's the lesser of two evils. Where does he go? If it's not Maguire and Stones, where does Southgate turn when there's a problem?
Yeah, it's huge. It's to me, it's the reason why they probably won't win the Euros, because their centre-back partnership, I mean, this will be Southgate's fourth tournament, and Maguire and Stones is going to be his centre-back pairing, all things being equal, for all four tournaments. And the previous three, it's not quite been good enough. So why are we thinking it's going to be fourth time around? I think it's, you know, there's a major issue with, I think Mark Gay here at Crystal Palace, I think would have been probably the next choice, the third centre-back, if you like. But he's kind of not really established himself at this level. He really likes Lewis Dunk. Dunk had a bit of a nightmare against Belgium. And again, not really established at this level. You know, Jarrod Branthwaite didn't get a look in this latest camp. And you do sort of look at it and think, well, Luke Shaw, I mean, if Luke Shaw's fit, I think he plays left back. I don't think he's not got the other options at left back to play him as a left-sided centre-back. you know, and try and experiment that way. So, look, I think this comes back to what England's sort of are in the midst, I think, of an existential crisis to some extent. And that is that because of all these attacking players that England have got, the criticism of Southgate is, you know, let the handbrake off, go and play these attacking players. You've got Bellingham, you've got Kane, you've got Foden, you've got Saka, you've got Rashford, you've got all of these top elite players delivering week in, week out for their clubs. Go and let them play, form a team that can go and take the Euros by storm. But the reason why he got a lot of criticism at the previous Euros, because he was playing Rice and Phillips as a kind of holding two in midfield, is because he knew his centre-backs weren't good enough as a back four, as a defensive unit, to just play a single pivot, play 4-3-3 and open up and be that a little bit more expansive and a little bit more creative and take more risks with the ball. And that is where we are now. Southgate's under almighty pressure, and Maynou's emergence has not really helped that, to be honest. Because, he's not really a six either, is he? Let's be honest. I mean, the second half against Belgium, he was playing increasingly further forward, pretty much on the edge of the box for a lot of that game when England had most of the ball. So, you know, people want Southgate to be this more attacking, handbrake off kind of manager. But I think he knows deep down that those centre-backs need more protection. And so I wouldn't surprise me if when we get to the tournament, England are playing maybe 4-2-3-1, letting Bellingham kind of go as a 10 and trying to have two sit in a little bit more, because he knows those centre-backs. And, you know, pace is a big problem. This is the other thing, right? This is why Kyle Walker is such a huge player for England. In that first choice back four, and let's assume that Shaw is fit, and it's Walker, Stones, Maguire and Shaw, there's nobody with pace in that back four apart from Walker. And his recovery pace, you watch England games where he's the one that covers, he covers off from fullback, he gets back in and he spares so many blushes. If England are going to be this team that plays 20 yards further up the pitch, that wants to dominate the ball, dictate play, you know, commit players in advanced areas, they're going to need to find a balance to that team that I'm not sure those centre-backs are good enough to allow them to play the way that a lot of people want England to play. And that you know, France have been there and done it. I don't think they have that issue so much as England do.
I find the comparison between Southgate and Deschamps and
well, we're not making a comparison.
Yeah, it's not a comparison. And while, yes, we could question Deschamps and the omission of Saliba this time around, Deschamps has shown that while he's willing to kind of go with his tried and trusted, Olivier Giroud in the World Cup final, if it isn't working out, he'll pull Olivier Giroud and put somebody like Colomwani on. Young players coming through. I've not seen that from Gareth Southgate. And while you can credit Southgate for his successes, relative successes as England manager compared to what we've seen before, he has, as James continues to point out, he continues to stick by who he's always has. And while that may have served you well, you've got to, at some point, this is not your second tournament. This is not your second year in the job. You've been here at this point. Of course there's going to be turnover. Of course there are going to be players aging out and young players coming through. To leave out Maynou for Henderson is easily the most bemusing decision I've seen a manager make for quite some time, given the form of both. I get, again, maybe Henderson gives you a lot off the field, but at some point, you've got to trust that you've built that culture to a point where those senior players can move on, can be left out. And if you don't trust that you've built that culture, then that reflects really poorly on the manager.
But let me go back to that point about Deschamps. The only reason Deschamps took Olivier Giroud off in a World Cup final when he did is because the big cheese Mbappe was chasing absolutely nobody back from a wide position. They were getting horsed down the... So he put him through the middle. That's the only reason he did it.
He put
Mbappe through the middle and he sacrificed Olivier Giroud because Mbappe wouldn't chase anybody back. And Argentina were tearing him apart down the wider areas. So, you know, to give England their credit, right, I don't know if they'll win this tournament or not. I think if I was a betting man, I'd say probably not. But, you know, they were a Harry Kane penalty away in that France game. They matched France, if not, were better than France for long periods in that game in the World Cup. It didn't happen for them. But they can take that forward, I think. I'm with James. Somehow got to solve And I think he's tried a back three before, but I just don't think he'll go to that. But he's got to find a conundrum that allows these others a bit more freedom to go and play, like we've talked about. But that's a difficult balance sometimes when you know you've got a few problems behind you. So you're a bit of a six and two threes. But yeah, I don't know if mine will go. I've lost track of where we are, but I've never talked for England for as long.
Or about international football, but we do know that you love the international break, and this segment has been evidence.
Doesn't
that
everybody
you
love
international
the international
football? Yes, Gab and Robbo do too. They're on the latest Gab and Jules show, looking back on all of it. That's dropped. Make sure to go and check it out wherever you get your podcasts.